Well, Dr Nazim Mahmood killed himself days after telling his family that he was gay, and in a 13-year-long relationship, the 34-year-old jumped to his death from the balcony of his flat in London last July. His partner set up a foundation in his memory to offer support to people struggling with issues of sexuality, gender and culture. Well, his partner's Matt Ogston, who I'm happy to say joins us now. Matt, very good morning to you, and thanks for coming in. I'm reading a quote here from the coroner in the inquest, Mary Hassell, who said this: "It seems desperately sad that in 2014 a person should feel that they can't be accepted because of the way they live, and I can only feel the deepest sympathy for Nazim that he felt so sad and desperate." Why do you think he was so desperate?
Well, imagine living in a society where you wake up one morning and you realise that your society is going to judge you for the colour of your skin. On top of that, you're then born into a religion which the media don't really give a good time to. And then on top of that as well, you're then gay as well. So you've got three things already making you having a hard time just to live a normal and free life.
Yes. How can the organisation that you're setting up to offer support deal with and help some of those challenges?
Well, based on our own experiences, we would like to use our own life as a lesson to help other people try and find strength in these situations and to try and understand whether they should come out to their family, whether it's the right thing to do to come out to the family, because as a gay person, coming out to your family is one of the hardest things you will ever have to do.
Let's turn the clock back on your relationship with Nazim. We're talking about a 13-year-long relationship here. How did you meet? What was it that brought you together?
Well, we met in Birmingham 13 years ago and we fell in love instantly. And we lived together in Birmingham for about a couple of years before realising that to live a free life where we wouldn't be judged, or where we could actually just get on with being normal people, trying to live good lives and do good things, we realised that we'd have to come to London to just be ourselves.
Was there anything that made, anything specific that made you think we can be more open and happy if we move away from Birmingham?
Moving away from a family where you know if the family found out about your relationship, they would try all they could to try and stop that relationship happening and existing. Moving to London with a fresh start where we just could create a new life for ourselves and meet an open, beautiful, lovely group of friends that we have who have been very supportive, but just being able to just walk down the street and not have to look over your shoulder and worry what's coming around the corner.
And tell us about what that new life was like, and I suppose more importantly, tell us about Nazim. What kind of man was he?
Nazim was the most inspirational, loving and caring man you will ever meet. Anyone who ever met him would fall in love with him. He was kind, he was caring, he just wanted to help other people to do good things. He was beautiful and inspiring, and everything he did was all about helping everyone else other than himself. And we together grew stronger and stronger over our relationship, and we created such a lovely life for us in London where we just wanted to just do good things for people.
You must have talked about this a lot, that the day would come when family would need to be fully appraised of what the situation was. I mean, presumably that was something you'd gone through with your own family. Tell us about that.
Coming out to my family was very hard, but my family have been absolutely wonderful, and they never, ever, ever saw it as an issue. And when they first met Naz, shortly after we met, they just accepted him as a person, as a human being, and their love and compassion never questioned whether we're in a relationship or not. It was just Naz and Matt are together and they are who they are. And they gave me the strength to carry on, and they give us both strength, and they became Naz's extended family.
Mm. And what about his family? I mean, clearly there are different cultural pressures that are brought to bear.
Yes.
And he, I'm presuming that he took longer to face up to the fact that he would at some point maybe have to talk to his family about this. What happened when he did?
Yes, well, he came to the conclusion that probably he would never be able to tell his family, because the impact of such would be catastrophic to our existence and our life. And he never actually, you know, came out to his family. His family asked him the question. And
because it's dangerous, isn't it? There's always a danger. I mean, you're only 200 miles away from Birmingham. There's always a danger, you know, you get rumbled, you get spotted.
Exactly. And that's why moving to London, because we didn't know anyone down in London, there were no family members down in London, we could live that free life. And coming to the conclusion that it's probably the best thing not to ever have to come out. But when faced with the question, are you gay?
When was that question put, and who put it?
It was put 2 days before he passed away. And because it wasn't a something that Naz wanted to say at that moment in time. It was a sad moment when that question was asked, and Naz was such an honest and caring person that when asked the question, he would always answer honestly. And when asked that question, he answered honestly, and then he admitted that he was gay. He was in a relationship with me for 13 years. We're fiancés, you know, we were going to get married together at some point in the near future.
And what was the reaction to that, to that openness, to that declaration of love, really?
It was underwhelming and also surprising, because the reaction was to basically ask him to see a psychiatrist to find a cure. And when he asked, why do I need to find a cure? There's nothing wrong with me. I'm just a good person trying to live a good life. That must have created such a sadness within Naz. And I only wish I had longer to have spoken to Naz to try and talk things through and just tell him it would be okay.
Because there's this 48-hour-long period, isn't there, between that conversation and that advice, in inverted commas, that he was given, and his death. What do you think happened during that two-day-long period? Because it's the critical time in his life, isn't it?
Trying to come to terms with what the future is. You know, we always planned ahead. We like to plan our lives to do, you know, to think ahead. But all of a sudden, this challenge thrown upon us, it created a sense of uncertainty where you no longer knew what the future was going to be. And that created an unsettling feeling within Naz that he just tried very hard to come to terms with.
Naz had no history of mental health problems, of depression. This was something which just completely pushed him over the edge. He clearly could not see a way out of this. I mean, there must have been such a profound sense of entrapment, of nowhere to turn.
Yes, it must have been. I just only wish we had longer to be able to talk it through.
How common do we think this is? I mean, the UK Asian population, big and growing. We know that the cultural pressures exist, religious pressures exist, not just within the Muslim community to which he belonged, but others as well, that there is a pressure. There's a pressure to see homosexuality as a problem that needs to be fixed. And, you know, sometimes this leads to the conclusion that you've witnessed all too tragically. How common do you think this problem is, and what could be done to deal with it?
It's more common than people think. And first of all, homosexuality is not a problem. This is who we are born as. We are normal people trying to live a normal life and just want to find acceptance and tolerance within communities. It's a very common problem because a lot of, you know, particularly gay Muslim men, they can't come out for fear of what's going to happen next. And it's the fear of what is going to happen or what you can't imagine might happen. Mm. And that's the fear that stops a lot of people from coming out, because it's you just want to get up each morning and just be normal and have a normal life and enjoy yourself. But this fear of what if, what's going to happen, what is the future going to be when you tell them, is the family going to do something, are they not going to do something, and I'm going to be, you know, struck out of the family. But more importantly, it's you know, you trying to find the love and acceptance from the family that gave birth to you is the hardest thing. And that fear of never finding acceptance from the people that gave birth to you is a very, very scary thing.
And finally, is this one of those things that incrementally, as the years roll by and attitudes change, the situation will improve? Or do we need to see something more active in terms of intervention? I mean, we've seen, for instance, in dealing with things like honour killings, that government can up the tempo, gear the police more towards dealing with this problem and setting exemplary sentences to make sure that the perpetrators are dealt with. Do you think that perhaps we need to do more at a legislative level, at a government level, to make clear that things have got to change?
What we need to do is talk more openly about it. You know, police intervention is not a solution, it's not a crime. What we need to do is at the grassroots level just start talking to communities and just open their eyes and just make them realise that those beautiful people they give birth to are their children, and God made all of us equally. If you believe in God, we are all equal. We were born equal. God created all of us. And so we need to act on the grassroots level and go into communities, schools, colleges, universities, community centres, and just make them aware and make them understand that being gay is a natural part of life.
For an Asian man, a gay Asian man watching, listening to your words this morning and thinking, I need to think some more about this. Perhaps I can draw upon your experience and Naz's experience as well. Where do they go to get the advice from your foundation? How do they find it?
Well, if they go to, we've set up a temporary website, nazamatfoundation.org. They can contact me through there. And together, just please find strength and hope. And don't give up. Don't give up. Please do not give up. Just keep going. Together we can make this better. We can work together and we can make this a better place to live.
Matt Ogston, thanks very much indeed for coming in and sharing your thoughts. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.